Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Wisconsin Institute for Public Policy and Service, UW-Marathon County, and the UW-Marathon County Foundation, we welcome you to the University of Wisconsin Marathon County for this evening's event, the second annual James F. Veninga Religion and Politics Lecture, entitled Laying Down the Sword, Why We Can't Ignore the Bible's Violent Verses, featuring Dr. Philip Jenkins. My name is Eric Giordano, and I am the director of WIPS. We are located here at the UW Center for Civic Engagement, and we'd like to thank you for being here and participating in our second annual lecture. I'd like to thank Dean Montgomery for hosting us in this wonderful facility. This evening's forum would not be possible without the support of the B.A. and Esther Greenheck Foundation, the Wisconsin Humanities Council, and the UW-Marathon County Lecture and Fine Arts Program here on campus. Many good people have worked behind the scenes to make this event possible. We would like to thank specifically our planning committee, who have been working very hard to put this event together, along with some connected community events I'm not sure all of you are aware of, including a discussion earlier today with students, a conversation with Naomi and Tip, and tomorrow an interfaith dialogue breakfast. I'd like to thank and recognize the planning committee members, Stephen Wright, John Visti, Jean Greenwood, James Powell, Connie Nikolai, Deb Mortensen, Luke Rudolph, and Zach Nikolai. At this time, although he is not going to appreciate it, I would also like to recognize Jim Veninga, former dean of UW-Marathon County, after whom this series is named, who is with us today in the audience. Tonight we're addressing a complex topic that matters to many of us. For this reason, we ask that you accord our guests and each other the courtesy and respect that we expect from a public forum dedicated to civil discourse. At this time, I'd like to introduce James Powell, Senior Lecturer in Religious Studies at UW-Marathon County, who will introduce our guest.
It's been my great pleasure today to hear Dr. Jenkins on two occasions, and I must say, get a great fix for my addiction to religion. Dr. Jenkins received a double first BA from Clark College, Cambridge, and getting a first at Cambridge is well beyond getting an A GPA in the American system. In addition, he got his MA and PhD also from Cambridge, and then unbelievably has written 14 books, over 120 articles, refereed in journals, and translated into 14 different languages. And the most recent of these, of course, the reason we're here is to review his thoughts of laying down the sword and why we can't ignore violence as we find it in the Bible. And in this sense, to demonstrate the awareness competencies, no religion has a monopoly on violence, and we can find as well the roots of violence in Judaism, Christianity, and Islam in the Hebrew Bible. So with that, I welcome Dr. Jenkins.
Hold on 1 second, where are we? Ah, good. Now, I realize many of you may be disturbed by that quote there, but I just want to make it very clear that also extends to women never do evil so gladly. Thank you very much for the very kind invitations, and thank you to the amazing achievements of the Policy Institute in laying on this weather, which I'm told is not typical of Wisconsin at this time. I talked about women never doing evil so gladly. I have a specific individual in mind. I want you to think of a terrorist and what an Islamic terrorist looks like, and what sort of name that person bears. And I want to tell you the story of an individual you may be hearing a lot about in the near future called Samantha Luthwaite, which is not what we think of as an Islamic name. Samantha Luthwaite is the daughter of a British soldier who converted to Islam, married a man called Jermaine Lindsay, who was one of the bombers who blew himself up in July 2005 in the London transport system. After a couple of years of basically denying that she knew he was a radical, she went underground and has since become the leader of Islamist terror cells in East Africa, and reputedly is one of the leaders of the attack on the mall in Nairobi. She's one of the people who people there claim to have seen shouting orders at other terrorists. The death toll in that incident will probably be about 150 by the time all bodies are counted. There are some occasions in history, that's not a very clear image, so bear with me on this one. On some occasions, we can look at religious motivation, and particularly scriptural motivation, for terrorist instances. This obviously is from the 9/11 attacks. And interestingly, we know the specific verses of the Quran that were going through the minds of the attackers on that day, because we have the directions they were given and the particular Quranic passages they'd been told to meditate on as they finalized their attacks. And these were particularly from two chapters of the Quran, usually surahs 8 and 9, Al-Anfal and At-Tawbah. And this is a screen cap from a film that was made a few years after the event by a European organization that believes that not just Islam is an evil religion, but that the Quran is an evil book that inspires murder, inspires violence, and inspires terrorism. And you'll notice you can say a lot about a text by how you present it. And what they've done here, prepare for them whatever force and cavalry you're capable of gathering to strike terror. You notice how that's separated out. And the idea there is that the Quran is a manual of terror and terrorism. Now, undoubtedly, it is possible to turn to texts in the Quran which are violent, which describe war, which advocate war against unbelievers. When, for instance, at Fort Hood a few years ago, Major Nidal Hassan killed some 13 American soldiers, we know what he was meditating on. It was something called the sword verse from the Quran. This has led some people, particularly in Europe, to suggest, as I say, that the Quran is an evil, homicidal text. It is a text of terror. And I ran into a problem some years ago. I wrote an article in the newspaper, and I said, well, you know, yes, indeed, there are texts like this, but, you know, there are also texts like this in the Bible. And there are some extremely bloody and savage and genocidal texts in the Bible. And let me just explain. When I talk about the Bible, I'm talking about especially books, parts of the book that Christians call the Old Testament and Jews call the Bible, the Torah. And that in fact, when you compared the two sets of scriptures, the biblical passages, if anything, came off worse. Now, what interested me and what led me to write the book was the reaction I got on this, which was extremely hostile. These are people with whom I will not be going on skiing vacations anytime soon. But what they suggested was this. First of all, no, these texts are not in the Bible. Yes, open the page. Secondly, well, they might be in the Bible, but they're just in the Old Testament, and that's not really the Bible. And in a sense, that's a very frightening idea. Because when you kind of play with that idea a little bit, this, by the way, is all great wisdom can be summarized on T-shirts. I'll leave you to read that one. That's from Richard Dawkins. Not just were people ignorant about these passages, that they could believe that they did not exist, but that they were suggesting almost that the God of the Old Testament was an alien God from the God of the New Testament. And you pursue that, and people have done that through history, and they've come to very ugly conclusions. They've suggested that the Old Testament is the book of the Jewish God, who is this primitive, bloody, savage creature from whom Jesus and this other good God came to rescue us. And that's a very dangerous and upsetting package. But it's interesting. How can people be so, who would say, yes, this is our religion, these are our scriptures, be so ignorant of some of these passages? And once again, as you see, there is a contrast here, and you'll excuse me, the angle I'm at, it makes it very difficult to read. Bear with me.
I assume you can read this. The New Testament
isn't about anger, it's about love. So you have this warped, angry old God of the Old Testament compared to this gentle, pacifist dude of the New. Technical theological phrase. Well, what are some of these phrases? And you see, that seemed to me to raise a lot of questions. First of all, was the way in which people read scripture. So for instance, some people would say, well, yes, those passages are in the New Testament, are in the Old Testament, excuse me, but they have to be read in the light of some of the passages about love and peace in the New. And I got back and said, well, yes, but those war passages in the Quran have to be read in the light of other passages. And clearly this was not an acceptable argument. I'd like to give you an example of what I mean when I talk about bloody passages. Now, please understand, I'm drawing a distinction here. The Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible, describes a violent, bloody world. There's no argument about that. And if the authors of the Old Testament were not describing these events, they would be failing in their duty. And so we read these absolutely horrendous stories of rape, of abuse, of cannibalism, of maltreatment. And yes, they're describing the world they knew, but not with any sense that God approved. So that's not a grounds to criticize the text. And then we come across Phineas. Let me make a suggestion. If you were a pastor or a priest in training, and you were given this passage, and you absolutely had to preach a sermon on it, what would you do? Let me tell you the story. The children of Israel are passing through the wilderness. Things have become very bad, and the Israelite men, or many of them, have married foreign pagan women, Midianites and Moabites. God is furious with this event and has sent a plague upon the people. Phineas, however, is a good and holy man, and he cannot contain his anger, and he picks up his spear, and he goes into a tent where there is an Israelite man and his Midianite wife, and he kills them both. And God is so pleased that he raises the plague. Would anyone care to deliver that sermon? In identifying the dangers of mixed-race marriages, no. And once again, if you think this is, to kind of phrase, ancient history,
One thing I want to stress is that stories like this have inspired action right up to the present day. In the 1990s, there was an organization called the Phineas Priesthood, which believed in attacking Jewish targets and mixed-race couples in the United States. You might have heard of one member of the Phineas Priesthood, whose name was Timothy McVeigh, who blew up the Oklahoma City office building. In the words of William Faulkner, the past is never dead. It's not even past. Okay. So that's the story of Phineas. It's a story in the Bible. It's a fairly freestanding one. Now just imagine that you met somebody who wanted to share their life verse with you. And this was the life verse they chose. And here's the setting. The Israelites are about to move into the land of Canaan, and God specifies the circumstances under which they shall move into Canaan. There are some people you can make treaties with. There are some people who will accept the status of serfs or slaves, but with others, they have to be eliminated entirely. They have to be subjected to the ban, a word I'll explain in a moment, or genocide. So if you met somebody and they said, I want to share my life verse with you, make no treaty with them and show them no mercy. This is not going to be the basis of a good relationship. And let me just say, that then is the theme for a large part of Deuteronomy and Joshua, where the Israelites move into the land of Canaan and carry out this policy and carry out a policy of genocide. Now, you might very well say, all right, that is the scripture, but whether you're a Christian or a Jew, you interpret these texts over time, particularly for Jews. Commentary is a very significant part of reading the text, in some cases more important than the text. Perfectly fine. But if you compare the text, the Quran and the Bible, okay, stand by. The Bible actually comes off worse for this reason. The Bible often talks about killing everyone. The Quran uses phrases like, we killed all our enemies. And when we'd done that, we took the prisoners and we let some of them go and we let some of them join us and then we sold others as slaves. So there's war in the Quranic context, but there are survivors. In this version, there aren't. I want you to note the sophisticated audiovisual aids here. You must not spare the life of any living being. Lay them under the curse of destruction. That is a word that occurs many times in the Old Testament, and it's a word that emerges as hirem. Hirem is the ban, the curse, and it is probably the most frightening single word in the Bible. What it means is, if you put a city under the ban, then you are absolutely pledged to kill every man, woman, child, and animal in the city, and also take all its treasure and destroy that treasure or give it to the priests. It has a lethal sanctity. You are not allowed to take it. It is put under this special religious category. And so, you know, I wrote about things like this, and people would respond, well, that's not in the Bible. Well, yeah, it is. Very heavily in Deuteronomy and Joshua. And this is a very absolute kind of picture. We utterly destroyed the men and the women and the little ones. And, you know, you may be thinking at this point, well, we're talking about the Iron Age. War then was very destructive. Is this unusual? It's not only unusual, it's unique. Let me explain. If you fight a war in ancient society, you want to kill the men and take as many of the women and children as possible as slaves. They are currency. That's not humanity, that's trade. Slavery is a main goal of war. The Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, is almost unique in the ancient world, and certainly in this period, in describing genocide. There are a couple of seeming exceptions, but all of them come from societies that were in close relations to Old Testament Israel. So something very strange is happening here. This is a theme that emerges through the history of art, and particularly with this great warrior called Joshua, who is the great warlord who leads all these battles. It's interesting. Through the centuries, artists have often depicted scenes from the Bible. And you might think, well, you know, every scene in the Bible must have been painted. From, you know, the crucifixion, the birth of Christ, Moses, and so on. All the pictures of Joshua depict him in battle, not in massacre. This is a classic. This is an event you all know. And if we could just all get together and sing, Joshua fought the battle of Jericho. Correct. And we all know the story of the battle of Jericho. We all know the story of the walls come tumbling down. We all know the story of the priests blowing the trumpets. What we don't know is the end of the story where they break into the city and kill every man, woman, child, and animal, with the exception of one family. Doesn't make good art. Oh, and by the way, there's one survivor, Rahab, who is the woman who assisted the Israelite spies, and her family is preserved. Oh, that's an interesting word there, isn't there? I know that you will take this land because of the terror you have inspired. If you want to talk about terror and scriptures, and you may think, why is that there? Well, like I said, the past is not past. The past is not dead, it's not even past. If the state of Israel today ever found itself on the verge of destruction, it would use its missiles and its nuclear warheads, and that is a Jericho 2. So apocalyptic images of destruction tend to carry on through. So there are basically three stories I want to look at. One is Phineas, one is the Canaanites, and... where are we? Exodus. Oh, yes. This is a story which has probably caused more blood through history than any other line in the Bible. And I could probably take a great many people in Sunday school classes and it would not register. Here's the story. The children of Israel are going through the wilderness. They're subject to a sneak attack by a people called Amalek, the Amalekites. And the response to this is so extreme. God says, not just you must destroy the Amalekites, you must blot out their name. The Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. And you may say, well, that's very unlucky if you're an Amalekite, but I haven't met many recently. There isn't an Amalekite American community. The last Amalekite probably died 3,000 years ago. Everyone in this room, by dint of their ethnicity or their religion, is potentially an Amalekite for some other person. Let me explain. Through history, Christians have used that text to justify the obliteration and extermination of Muslims. Protestants have used it to justify the destruction of Catholics and vice versa. White people in the age of empire used it to justify the destruction of of Native Americans, of Indians, of Africans. And the Amalekite text has been a very potent and damaging text. It is also different from the Quranic text in one way. The Quranic texts say, go fight a war. This is much more sweeping. This advocates destruction. And here are some attempts to represent the Amalekites at war.
Ah, yes.
I want to focus on one particular passage, 1 Samuel 15. Here is the story as it emerges in that chapter. God commands the raising of Saul to the kingship. First part. God then commands Saul to go and attack the Amalekites and wipe out every man, woman, child, and animal. In other words, to inflict harem upon them. King Saul, being a rational sort of Iron Age king, goes out and defeats them, kills many of them, but not all. He lets live the Amalekite king, whose name is Agag, and also a good number of animals. God is furious that Saul has disobeyed him, and he sends the prophet Samuel to go and send a message saying, I told you to kill everyone. Why has the genocide not been complete? Okay, the word genocide is not in the Bible, but killing every man, woman, and child is genocide. Saul realizes how badly he has behaved, and the prophet Samuel then kills and dismembers the king, Agag. Once again, if you're a theology student, if you're training for the priesthood or to be a pastor, how would you like to preach on that one? Because many people have through history. And the lesson they take from it is usually God's orders are absolute. They may not seem reasonable or rational to us, but we have to obey them. When the Pilgrim Fathers come over in the 17th century, they draw up an elaborate compact and specifically refers to this story that says, we have a contract with God. Saul had a contract with God. We know what happened to Saul when he failed in his duty. It'll happen to us. And now, let's go meet the Indians. By the way, if you're a member of a Christian church, if you're a member of the Catholic Church, most of the mainline churches, Lutheran, Baptist, Episcopal, if you're a member of many evangelical churches, you may never have heard this passage read in your church for this reason. Those churches all use something called the Revised Common Lectionary. It tells you that this particular Sunday, for instance, we'll be reading this Old Testament passage, this New Testament passage. The Revised Common Lectionary is one of the most heavily censored books in religion. And what it does is this. And God appointed Saul as king. And then God was really sorry that he'd appointed Saul as king and decided to get rid of him. Excuse me, what happened here? Now, you're very welcome to go off to the Bible and look what's been left out. How many people do? So it just left, God changes his mind. But the massacre has been left out. It's been edited. It's been redacted. It's been purged. Yeah, and incidents of Samuel and Agag? Yeah. I won't say too much about that, but there are any number of other passages I could refer to. That's an early synagogue wall painting of the Book of Esther, which is a story which, again, has a great deal of bloodshed in. Well, let me tell you why these stories relate, because they do. There's a very strange book in the Bible called Esther. How strange is it? It's the only book of the Bible that doesn't mention the word God. It's the first book of the Bible to mention the word Jew. And it tells the story of a plot at the Persian court to exterminate the Jews. And the plotters are led by an evil king called Haman. And Haman is one of the great villains in Jewish history. And the whole thing's it's a fairy tale. It involves all these great battles and conspiracies and so on. But over time, Jewish scholars wrote commentary on this, And you think, well, why did Haman so hate the Jews? And they added an explanation. And anyone care to guess? Anyone want the film rights? Haman explains, you know why I hate you? Because I am a descendant of King Agag. I am an Amalekite. There is an eternal race war between my people and yours. You want to destroy us, we want to destroy you. So when you have the Jewish feast of Purim, they commemorate the events of Esther, and both those stories come back. And you think, well, what does this have to do with the present day? The recently former president of Iran, Persia, was Mr. Ahmadinejad. And if you look at this cartoon, you'll see that he's portrayed as Haman fighting for the Amalekite cause. You know, some people ask why Israel is so determined, so fanatical about preventing Iran getting a nuclear weapon. And there actually was a quote a year or two ago where they tried to explain this. They asked an aide to Prime Minister Netanyahu, why is he so obsessed with Iran? And there was an interesting answer. Two words. Think Amalek. If anyone ever tells you this is ancient history, it's not. Well, suppose you have these texts. What do you do with them? Through history, some Christians at least have taken these texts very seriously as grounds for action. When the First Crusade was declared in 1095, the Pope did a sermon about the need to destroy Amalek. When settlers landed in the New World, they got sermons about Amalek and kicking out the Canaanites. There's a great 18th century critic of the Bible, one of the pioneering Bible critics called Matthew Tyndall, and he basically says, you know, the Spanish wouldn't have done all they did in the Indies if they hadn't used them as they were treating them like the Canaanites. This is sort of an interesting picture. Around about the early 20th century, about 1904, the Germans had a great colonial empire in Africa, in Southwest Africa. All the European powers had colonial empires, but the Germans were different. And the Germans faced a revolt by what were called the Herero people. And the Germans issued an order called a Vernichtungsbefehl, which is an extermination order, which directly quoted the biblical texts on the Canaanites to exterminate the Herero. Not just to kill them, defeat them, but to exterminate them. They actually managed to kill 80%. Some of the Germans who were responsible for that operation later ended up killing Armenians in World War I, and some of those ended up plotting the Holocaust. So there is a very direct strand there. Now, of course, all this is ancient history, so let's go forward to 1994. In 1994, there was a great conflict in the African land of Rwanda. You had a people called the Hutu, who wanted to exterminate a minority tribe called the Tutsi. The worst people in that era, the people who carried out the most spectacular acts of genocide, were Christian clergy. The most dangerous place to go if you're a Tutsi on the run was a Christian church. There's one church, one Adventist church, where 10,000 bodies were recovered. A total of 800,000 people were killed. And we have the words of one pastor. And you can read it. He compared the Tutsi to the Amalekites and said, you know, you have to kill everybody, every man, woman, and child, or else God will be angry with you like he was with Saul. And I love the last line. And the people said, amen. And they did. So, oh, yeah, and I've talked about Christian stories in that way. There is also a Jewish angle. There are some far-right Jewish terrorists. The State of Israel does its best to fight them. Sometimes it fails. In, again, about 1994, a Jewish extremist went into a mosque on Purim to kill Amalekites. He killed 28 Muslim worshippers. And you might say, well, he was crazy, he was a loner, but as you see from that story, he became a folk hero among other far, far right extremist Israelis who believed that there was an eternal task to fight Amalek. Still today, when Israelis try and mount a gay rights parade in Jerusalem, posters will go up saying, "This is Amalek." And one poster that went up particularly said, "What we need is a new Phineas." Who is Phineas? Phineas was the assassin. We need terrorism. Okay. I've described some very kind of harrowing and unsettling texts, and if I was Richard Dawkins, I'd stand here saying, "And that's what's wrong with Christianity and Judaism and religion." What I actually want to say is something rather different. I want to look at different ways of reading Scripture, of approaching Scripture. How do you deal with texts that most of us, all of us, find repulsive? And basically, there's a number of answers. Christians and Jews have spent a couple of thousand years dealing with these problems. And there's one basic answer, which is you say, "God says it, I believe it, that settles it," to quote the bumper sticker. John Calvin said very frankly, "Look, each of us, every one of us, deserves death because we are such awful sinners. Who are we to criticize God for visiting death on some particular sinners like the Canaanites, like the Amalekites? The potter, the clay, does not criticize the potter. We do not criticize our Creator. Divine orders rule." And there are any number of statements like that that I could give you. This is one of my favorites. You may have never heard of Reuben Torrey. Reuben Torrey was a very famous evangelical in the early 20th century. You heard of the fundamentalists? They all take their name from a series of books called The Fundamentals, and Reuben Torrey was one of the key authors. And what he said was, not just was it a good thing killing the Canaanites, but boy, I wish we could kill so many people today in the same way. It'd make life so much better. And people who should have known better. If you know anything about biblical archaeology, you know about William Foxwell Albright. He's the inventor of biblical archaeology, 1930s, 1940s. Look at some of the things he said. This is a man who was very pro-Jewish in 1940. In 1940, one of the worst years in the history of the world, he said this. Where are we? Basically, there's a point beyond which racial mixing cannot proceed without disaster, and it's a good thing the Canaanites were destroyed. That's an amazing remark. He also talked about strong, vigorous races being able to preserve their identity. This is remarkable stuff. Very fortunately, most Christians and most Jews through history have been much more subtle. What I like are the ways in which, through history, Christians and Jews have taken what are apparently very explicit scriptures and bent them. So, for example, you have this passage about kill everybody, show them no mercy. What do the Talmudic texts say about that? Well, that's what the text says. Now, this is what really happened. Joshua went to these cities, and he gave them a choice. He said, you have a choice. You can stay and fight. You can serve us. Or you can go into exile, and God will give you a really nice country somewhere else. And so the ones who stay are the ones who are really stubborn. And there's a nice little touch at the end there, which is, and God gave the rest of them a great country somewhere else in Africa where they were very happy. And if you know the history, it's then, and then the Romans exterminated them, but it wasn't us. One of my favorites in that way is you have this Amalekite text, and you have the story of Haman as this absolutely evil leader of the great Amalekite plot. And in one of the Talmudic texts, it almost adds as a footnote, by the way, Haman's descendants became Jews and learned Torah. I thought we were meant to exterminate them. Well, it's complicated. So there is an attempt, and Christians do it and Jews do it, to humanize, to say, this is our moral response to this story. We want to make it something that is not as bad and bloody as appears. We want to make God look better. What the Talmudic texts do with Phineas is fascinating. So instead of saying, well, he got up and picked up his spear and killed people, it's he got up, went out of the official assembly where he had been discussing action, and went off to kill people. These ancient rabbis knew very well, if you let every Tom, Dick, and Phineas go about killing people randomly, this was a very dangerous setup. So he was carrying out an execution. Oh, and by the way, he suffered such terrible guilt afterwards that it almost drove him crazy. They edit. They try and make it better. Christians have a slightly different approach. From very, very early on in the church, they refuse to treat these texts as if they refer to real history. So, for instance, one of the great early fathers is a man called Origen in Alexandria. And Origen is dealing with all these people who say, your God is a terrible monster. He commands these awful murders and massacres and so on. And Origen says, look, if these were historic events, I agree with you 100%. There's no way you can justify a God who does that. But of course, only a very stupid person would take that as history. These are symbolic events. God said, go fight the Canaanites. Well, see, these Canaanites, they actually represent evil impulses within us. At one point, Joshua goes off to kill five kings who've taken refuge in a cave. I could almost make this an exam. Can anyone tell me what the five kings are? Obviously, you've got to fight the sins of sight, hearing, smell, touch. In other words, everything is symbolic. Where we are. Oh yeah. Let me move on a little bit from there. And here's Oregon. These are not, how shall I say, no actual Canaanites were harmed in the making of this scripture. That these are symbolic, psychological events. Of course we're meant to strike down these evil forces. We call them Midianites, we call them Canaanites. This really doesn't matter. Oh, I'll come back to this in a second. But one of the very common responses has been to edit, to pretend the texts are not there. And if you look at something like the Revised Lectionary, it's really interesting how much it does these things. You know, one of the loveliest psalms in the Bible, you probably all know the opening, which is, by the waters of Babylon, by the rivers of Babylon, we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange country? Now, for those of you who are really old and you remember an era called the 1970s, you might remember that a song based on this was an international disco hit. Disco was a form of evil in ancient times. Which was by the rivers of Babylon. And what they did was exactly the same as what they did in the Revised Lectionary, which is they leave out the last verse. Because the last verse is, you know, we're in captivity in Babylon. Blessed is he who takes your little ones and smashes their heads against the rock. When you read the New Testament, and I'm an Episcopalian, save your sympathy, when we read the resurrection account, Like many churches that do the revised lectionary, they read, and the apostles were all gathered together in a room, and they then leave out the next five words, which are in the New Testament, which are, for fear of the Jews. We censor the Bible a lot. But the classic example is what happens with these violent texts. Large parts of Joshua, large parts of Deuteronomy, large parts of Ezra, Nehemiah, are missing in liturgical action. They have dropped out of the texts altogether. Now, at this point, you may be saying something, which is, why does it matter? Why does it matter that we are missing so much of the Bible? I want to suggest why. Firstly, we live in a time of very dramatic Christian expansion around the world, in Africa, in Asia especially, and people are coming to the Bible afresh without the kind of background that Westerners have, without the kind of self-censoring mechanisms. It would be good to give them some guidance. What have we figured out from a couple of thousands of bloody years? But most of us aren't even aware those books are there. You know, and I'm looking at East Africa right now. One of the great fears is after this horrific massacre of Christians in Nairobi, Christians are going to go out and strike Somalis. Wouldn't it be good if Christians in the West could say, let us tell you about 2,000 years of our experience? We can't presently. When a Richard Dawkins or a Sam Harris launches an atheist attack on Christianity and says, you have these dreadful scriptures, and the Christian response is, no, we don't. Oh, my Lord, yes, we do. Does it say that really? It's very hard to counter that challenge. But there's a much more important reason than that. The passages that we are talking about here come from books that are integral to the Bible. They are not incidental. They're not extra bits tacked on. Why are they so essential? Firstly, Jesus uses a number of Old Testament texts more than most. Deuteronomy is one of the ones he uses most. When the devil tempts Jesus in the wilderness, three questions, three answers, all Jesus' answers come from Deuteronomy. It was clearly a text he was supposed to have felt very much at home with. What's Jesus' name? It is Jesus. It is Joshua. If you ever read the Old Testament in Greek, you're in for a shock. Because when you get to the book of Joshua, you get, and Jesus went to the city and killed all the children. What? Jesus is Joshua. Jesus is portrayed as being the new Joshua. How do we deal with this? But I want to suggest that there is no need for panic. There is no need for despair here. What I think we have to do is understand a couple of things. And I can talk a lot about this in questions. You know, we can get into this at much greater length. But short story. Did those massacres ever happen? I can't talk about Amalekites. There would have been such a tiny number. We haven't got a clue. Canaanites I can talk about. As described in the Bible, the invasion and slaughter of the Canaanites did not happen. That the cities that were destroyed, allegedly by the Israelites, either were not there at the time the Israelites arrived or were not destroyed. Some cities were destroyed at odd times, but we cannot say this city's destroyed, this city's destroyed, this city's destroyed. It's just not possible. As far as we can tell, if you look at the origins of the Israelites, at least some, and probably a good number, grew out of the Canaanite population. In other words, they were probably Canaanites who literally had fled to the hills as society had collapsed due to climate change, invasion, economic collapse. They took to the hills in Judea. They emerge as a new, fresh society. The oldest Hebrew writing we have is in Canaanite script. You cannot draw a line and say, here are the Canaanites, evil, bad, to be destroyed. Here are the Hebrews coming in. It cannot be done. But that leaves you with kind of a whopping question. So you get to the years 800, 700, when people are putting together these biblical texts, 400 and 500 years after the events described. They seem to be sane, reasonable human beings with a very high view of God. Why would they make God out to be such a monster? And I think there's an explanation, which goes like this. They were working at a time when the very existence of the people of Israel was in deep danger. They were surrounded on all sides by great hostile empires, above all the Assyrians, who were genuinely terrifying, who would absorb and conquer people. They also faced an enormous danger of cultural assimilation. We might not be physically conquered, but we can be culturally conquered. And I think that's the time at which people wrote books like Joshua, or edited books like Joshua, to send a message. You took over this country. You came into this country because God let you, and God kicked out the people who were here before because they betrayed him. Do you see the lesson for you? God can give this country to anyone. And the more they stress the horror of what happened to the Canaanites, the more you see a warning of what is being held out to the Israelites. So I think when you've tried editing the text, pretending the text is not there, denying the text, you have one option left, and that's to try and confront it. And that's to try and deal with it historically, which is what I'm trying to do whenever I set an exam. I always say at the beginning, you know, when all else fails, answer the question. And that's what I'm trying to do, to confront the text as it is. In fact, I would love to see churches in a particular community devote themselves for several months just to preaching on the texts of blood. You can see people trembling at the moment. But you know, I love what the New Testament does with this, and I really wanted to end with this particular story. This is one of the New Testament miracles, and here's the story. Jesus is walking along in the basically the far north of the country, near what we would now call Lebanon, and he meets a pagan woman. And she's often called a Syro-Phoenician woman. And the woman says, please heal my daughter. And Jesus says, I'm not here to help you. Right now, I'm here to help the people of Israel. I'm not going to take what's meant for the children and give it to dogs. It's a very tough passage to deal with. And the woman says, yeah, but the dogs sit under the table and eat scraps. Can't I do that? And Jesus says, well, all right, that's a good saying. I'm going to heal your daughter. And she goes home. But here's the point. In Matthew, she's not a Syrophoenician woman. She's a Canaanite woman. She's the Canaita. And so, in other words, if you read it in Greek, the book of Joshua is about Joshua, Jesus, killing all the Canaanites. The Gospel of Matthew is about Jesus, Joshua, healing Canaanites. So we've come full circle. So people have recognized these problems for a very, very long time, but they've also tried to find solutions to them. Where are we? Oh, yeah. And I'll just end with a quote from William James. As you know, there's William James and there's Henry James, and the wrong one ended up writing novels. This is William James. We're often told in the Bible to remember. We're told to remember the words of the Lord, remember the Sabbath. It's a very important thing that we have to do sometimes, or we do sometimes, and that's to forget. And it's a great danger, but sometimes it's the only way that it makes life livable. So in the practical use of our intellect, forgetting is as important as remembering. So what I'm suggesting is, look at those texts, read the biblical text as a whole. If you want to remain at the, what's the least offensive word? If you want to remain at a dumb level of saying, we can use these to criticize and make fun of religion and attack religion, do so if you wish. But what you can do is you can take these texts, integrate them into the larger biblical story, and when you understand them, then you can approach other religions and speak to them on a level of understanding and learn that all religions have troubling texts, all religions can learn to deal with them. And maybe there's even a point where Christians and Muslims and Jews can get together and decide, well, what can you teach us about handling your texts of terror, your books of blood? Because that's what we have. And I thank you very much. And I shall wind up at that point. I am going to try and recognize questioners. I would ask for your sympathy on one thing, which is I have a spotlight aimed directly at me, which is not entirely good for seeing people. I believe there are some people over there, but who knows? So, if anyone has any questions, and someone will be with you shortly with a microphone. I'm completely dazzled, I'm sorry. Remind me not to walk about 4 feet forward. We have questions here, please. Thank you so much.
I would like to ask you about René Girard.
Okay, sure.
And I won't say anything more than that. I presume you know a whole lot more than I do about him.
Well, that might be a bold assumption, but René Girard is one of the great scholars working on the topic of violence and the sacred, and tries to explore these topics. The great insight of his that I admire so much is he talks about the Bible and violence and the extreme violence there. But he says, you know, what you've got to appreciate is the Bible is the first book that treats violence and persecution and suffering from the point of view of the victim. And he makes an interesting point. When we read a story like this about the Canaanites, for example, we today read that and say, oh my Lord, that's terrible, that's horrible. Why do we think that? And René Girard would say, because the Bible has so sensitized us to the suffering of the innocent that we no longer react as people would have done in virtually all previous societies. Well, people were killed in large numbers, too bad. Because of the Bible, we have learned to criticize the Bible. In other words, it's part of the, if you like, the moral progress of humanity. Did you want to add anything to that, or is that a would that hit the main issues? Anyone else? By the way, I must confess to a guilty pleasure in films. There's a film that came out in the 1930s that I love dearly. And it's not shown that much these days because some of the images in it are felt to be very racially stereotypical. There's a film called Green Pastures. And it basically had every African-American actor and singer of the day. And it's a fascinating thing. But one of the things it does is it presents an idea which is just wonderful, where we see the story of the Bible from the point of view of God, who is a black Southern preacher. But the whole point about the film, 1936, is that God begins as this angry, spiteful, judgmental character, and as time goes by, through watching human suffering and human ability to cope under suffering, he becomes more human and more merciful, and it culminates with him giving his life in the form of Christ. And it's just one of these rare examples where you have a musical teaching really important theology that I think René Girard would have enjoyed enormously. And I think we have a microphone right here.
Dr. Hey. Jenkins, I'm going to prevail upon you. I was at your luncheon presentation and you ran out of time before you could expound on Buddhist violent verses.
Sure.
And I was hoping you could at least enlighten me a little on that.
Well, the point I was making is that all religions, to the best of my knowledge, have violent scriptures. Now, please remember, I did not say that all religions or denominations have been equally violent, not in any sense. Nor, importantly, is there any link, any correlation between the violence of scriptures and the violence of the people who read them. For instance, some of the most apocalyptic sects, the people who believe the world is going to end very shortly, tend to be very pacifistic, just on the basis of, I'm not going to hurt you, but when God comes, ooh. Buddhism has some very violent scriptures. It has one of my favorites. I'm blocking the name of the actual sutra, but it records a war of a Buddhist king. And we are told that this king kills, you know, like 100,000 people, and is then blessed when a bodhisattva appears to him and explains to him that, you know, these were not really Buddhists, no matter what they thought. They all represented really bad incarnations, so don't worry. So there are violent and warlike Buddhist scriptures. Some Buddhist kings, some Buddhist regimes have been extremely, violent and tyrannical. The West tends to have a very idealistic view of Buddhism, which is often used as a stick to beat Christianity and Judaism. In reality, as I say, it's a much more complex picture. Back in the 90s, a book came out which was about Zen at war. And it looked at Zen Buddhist monasteries in the 1930s and 1940s. And it has this picture at the front, which is jaw-dropping. And it shows all these Zen Buddhist monks marching along with rifles on the way to bayonet practice and so on. So I cannot give you a specific catalogue of scriptures, but I'm just saying that violence in religion is a very equal opportunity phenomenon. I think in the West we used to think it was very much, you know, Christianity, the Crusades, blame Islam, but it's pretty much all the great religions.
Violence, you said violence in religion is equal
opportunity.
Equal opportunity. But one of the realities that in the Bible, violence is situationally specific. God commanded it for a reason, for a purpose, for a situation. It was not promoted as a way of life. Whereas in the Quran, it is promoted as a way of life for the future, for all peoples of all generations to be carried on with no specific situation in mind.
I appreciate the clear way you phrase that contrast. I don't agree with it for this reason. First of all, a passage like the Amalekite passage is a war against the Amalekites forever. That's against one specific people who are Amalekites. There is also a great deal of disagreement in scholars of the Quran as to whether those particular texts, notably Surahs 8 and 9, were exactly as you said, situationally specific. There are certainly Muslim scholars today who would say these represented combat at a particular time in the development of the Muslim community, in a particular time in Muslim history. And they don't lay any obligation on later generations. Now, I can certainly find commentaries that say that in Islam, but I can also, if we're going to compare like with like, I can find commentaries in Judaism, and I can find patristic commentaries in Christianity that talk about some of these instances of violence and hate running beyond the situationally specific to be enduring or eternal. If we just compare the scriptures, I don't see a difference. What we deal with, like in the sword verse, for example, is something which was a response to a particular set of circumstances in the 620s. And if people today choose to believe that it applies to them, they are following one tradition, but not the only tradition. So respectfully, I would disagree with you on that contrast. Is gentleman the... pardon me. Yep.
Can you please give me a significant example of violence in the reference of Quran?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that? Can I give you a reference to...
Significant example of violence in the reference of Quran.
Violence, I'm sorry, please excuse me. Violence in the Quran, boy. Well, I'm thinking, for instance, in Surahs 8 and 9, you get a lot of these quotes about, go fight, fight in this battle, lay ambushes for your enemies, for unbelievers, and so on. I mean, there are a great many passages like that.
Okay.
But particularly in those two quite lengthy surahs, which are war surahs, later on, somebody might look at these and say, take them in a symbolic form, and say, well, yeah, of course you've got to go fight these evil forces. You've got the lesser jihad, which is the holy war against material enemies, and then you've got the greater jihad against the evil forces inside us. Again, that's commentary. But no, I find no problem finding violent passages in the Quran. It's just a question of how they dominate, or whether they are meant to be, if you like, a permanent guide for Muslims, which I do not believe.
As a group in today's world...
Does somebody have a microphone there?
This man had the next question.
Okay, Ewan, we'll come back.
Dr. Jenkins, thank you for your presentation. I just wanted to read one quote from your book and then form my question on that, if that's okay. On page 111, you say...
Oh, page 111, sure.
Page 111. I'll read it to you. It says, in the case of the conquest, literalists have a hopeless choice. They can avoid the moral dilemmas posed by the massacres by saying that these events did not happen in anything like that way. Unfortunately, that approach would make nonsense of any claims of biblical infallibility.
Right.
Alternatively, they can accept wholeheartedly that the massacres did happen as described and then grapple with the theological issues raised by God's command of genocide. So my question then is, with the concern of saying, well, these battles did not happen with the Canaanites, then where does that end? So what if someone were to say, and the resurrection didn't happen and water to wine didn't happen and Jesus didn't really walk on water? And so once we start saying that didn't happen, how do we deal with the rest of those issues?
Okay. Certainly a question which many people might ask, and my answer would be, from a literalist point of view, every passage of the Bible has to stand and fall together as being of equal importance. I do not see that as being, if you like, a binary between, on the one hand, you believe everything or you believe nothing. I believe that there are different books, different degrees of authority for different statements, different degrees of evidence. You know, I asked about the massacres. I would ask another question. You then have the scene where Joshua is fighting his enemies. He's winning, but he needs more light for the day. And God gets the sun to stand still long enough for him to defeat his enemies. Well, you can say many things about that miracle, but that did not happen in the sense of the sun. It's based on the idea that the sun goes round the earth. I do not know how literalists deal with that, because you know literalists generally believe in the heliocentric system. I don't see it as a case of anything goes versus accept everything. I believe it's, if you like, a matter of stages, a matter of degrees. If you look at the resurrection, I believe you've got something with a massively, massively different amount of historical evidence and criteria. So I do not see that as a slippery slope argument. I am not a biblical literalist, but I do not see that as a major blow or weakness in faith. So I don't see it as either or. I suppose, but I would remind you about the sun standing still. What one does with that, if you are a strict literalist, I don't know. It's a tough one. The gentleman back there wanted to follow up. Should we just do that while we are? Oh, whichever. It's your mic.
As two groups in the modern world, do you feel that either Muslims or Christians, that one is more humanitarian than the other?
I believe that wealthy countries, which are much more likely to come from the Christian tradition, have a much stronger tradition of humanitarianism. I do not believe that that is a function of religion, its difference of culture and economic basis. Clearly in the modern world, Europe and America massively lead the field in that way, as they would not have done 400 years ago, 300 years ago. So there's one person, there's one lady here, and there's also, hi, how are you? Sure.
Oh, yes, Dr. Jenkins, there's just maybe one thing I might take issue with, and this is the idea, for example, in Buddhism and Taoism, that they would have an equal share of violence. And I'm thinking, in particular, the Buddha rejected Hindu war traditions, the caste system welcomed in, you know, male prostitutes into his community and forbid the killing even of insects. It seems pretty clear to me that this idea of holy war is really an Abrahamic preserve, a unique characteristic of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. So even though we see Burmese Buddhists killing Muslims today, is it really fair, or I mean, isn't it true that this is really unique to these Abrahamic traditions, this particular style of violence?
So you started off by saying that Buddha rejected the Hindu tradition of holy war. So Hinduism had a tradition of holy war.
Yes, in the Mahabharata we can see, you know, Krishna is famous for Indeed. Advocating the killing of
he wasn't Abrahamic.
His enemies. What's that?
He wasn't Abrahamic.
No, he was not, but that's why I'm distinguishing Buddhism, because okay. The Buddha explicitly
right.
rejected all those Hindu traditions and Lao Tzu of Taoism as well. There's just nothing comparable.
Actually, I entirely agree with you about Taoism. I am not aware of anything in that. However, I would draw a distinction. Please understand what I'm comparing. I'm comparing the scriptures. I'm not comparing the whole historical experience of the different religions. You're undoubtedly right in saying that about the Buddha, as I would be right in saying that it's very hard to imagine Jesus himself involved in a holy war. However, both of them have a corpus of scriptures in which that element is there, ready to be exploited. When it's in the interest of people to take those scriptures selectively. I don't want to say, you know, historically one has waged as many wars as the other, partly because Buddhism vanishes from large sections of Asia, certainly from India, and doesn't have the same sort of state power. Maybe the biggest variable is whether a religion has state power, whether they have states to play with. You know, it's very hard to run holy wars if you don't have states. That's one reason why there are so few Jewish wars, holy wars, over long centuries. But there is a tradition of holy war in Judaism. A point of disagreement. I have no idea who is the lady here, and then a couple of folks. You fight it out.
I want to thank you for a lot of the information that you shared in earlier today when I sat in on a session. When you talk about scriptures or things being edited, that's given me more information. This may seem trivial, but I had once attended a presentation that happened to be done by a priest. And as simple as this may seem, and I understand that you are comparing scriptures, he had wrangled, maybe is the word to use, or noodled over the idea of what word is most commonly found in scripture.
Okay.
And I think he was referring to the Old and New Testament.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that you looked at? Because I'll tell you the answer he shared, but...
Okay, tell me.
He said forgiveness.
Most common in scripture?
Yes. When he counted the words, apparently, he took some time at a retreat or something and counted out how often.
Let me give you a very serious answer there. I don't know. That should be easy to work out, but it depends if you're meaning like all words, including, you know, and, went, beget, and so on, or if you're just talking about you know, nouns in the context of speeches or what. So I really don't know, but I would be awfully surprised. There are a lot of words in the Bible. I mean, seriously, you look at the New Testament, for example, and just look at how much of the New Testament is narrative, you know, and they went to the city, okay? So I would love to see the, I'd love to see the presentation. I'm a little surprised as that's presented. Is there a great deal of forgiveness in the Bible? Yes, undoubtedly. Is it, you know, a core message of Judaism and Christianity? Undoubtedly. There's an awful lot of forgiveness in Islam also.
The two words that he came up with,
this gentleman had a follow-up
Sorry,
question.
Sorry, if I may.
My question is... Oh,
sure, please, carry on.
Okay. When I look at the title of your book, which I like, my immediate response was Christ did lay down the sword, like at his arrest when Peter pulled out his sword and Jesus mm-hmm. said, if my kingdom was of this world, I'd have you fight for it. And so he did lay down the sword. And when I study Islam, and I'm not an expert and I have not read the whole Quran, but it seems like Muhammad, there was more violence in the conquest of Mecca, Medina, things like that. So I see that as a key difference in my understanding of the two.
By the way, in terms of the scriptures, I've deliberately talked about the texts of blood in the Old Testament. In the Christian tradition, if there is a text that has been invoked more than any to justify violence, it's the New Testament book called Revelation. Because Revelation does not describe an actual physical war in this world, like, you know, go out and kill Romans now. But through history, Revelation has been enormously attractive to warring states, to lone individuals, to lone terrorists. And why? Partly because it so absolutely demonizes the enemy. Oh, and let me just add one thing. Revelation is the only book in the New Testament where the call to action, the sequence of actions, directly follows the Old Testament law of harem. And the whole harem idea is implicit to the way the trumpet is sounded, the angels gather, the horsemen go forth. And that is a visionary New Testament image of Kerem. And as I say, is Revelation about war? Well, yes, not a war that has happened yet, but oh, it has inspired. It's an incredible phantasmagoric book. And incidentally, not coincidentally, it's probably inspired more art and more dreams and more visions than any other part of the Christian Bible. So I could also talk about that. But and there's somebody there. Oh, and then somebody two seats in front.
Can we lay down the sword, and how do we do it?
Depends who we are. In terms of different religions, you know, if I was to ask you, you know, do Christians today engage in holy war? You'd say no. You know, haven't done it for centuries. Well, I would say, well, just 100 years ago, the world was about to go into the First World War, where every participant except one was a Christian nation, and everyone used the language of holy war, Armageddon, and crusade. The only exception was the Islamic regime of Ottoman Turkey, which did declare a jihad, but it was pretty mild compared to what the English, the French, the Germans, the Italians, and the Russians were doing. So we're dealing with modern times. Secondly, if you look at Christianity worldwide, there was a jihad, there was a Christian harem war in Rwanda just 20 years ago. Could it happen again? Sure. You know, there was a phrase that was impressed as me from a Nigerian Anglican bishop, and he was describing this series of horrific massacres of Christians in central Nigeria. And he said, the Lord commanded us to turn the cheek and turn the other cheek. We have no cheeks left. And at some point, he said, the God of the Old Testament may be what we need. I think we will see Christian holy wars in our lifetimes. Not in Wisconsin, we hope. But in different parts of the world, sure. And what I would like to see is, you know, the West has so many resources in terms of wealth, media, education. It has 2,000 years of its religious heritage. Can't it tap those and try and help people? And I suppose the best way of avoiding those kind of wars is to prevent them happening and to remove and diffuse the circumstances and the persecutions that caused them to happen. That's one reason, by the way, why I was campaigning so furiously over the past few months to try and stop the U.S. getting involved in Syria and creating a new kind of holy war situation there that would destroy Christianity in that region. Can we lay down the sword? Yeah, but we're a long way off. Sometimes I don't like to quote this because of the source, but, you know, Mahatma Gandhi was once asked, what he thought of Western civilization. And, you know, his answer, I think it would be a wonderful idea. The reason I don't like the quote is Gandhi, again, has this great reputation as being this sort of great saint and humanitarian. You look at the system he wanted to set up in India. It was a very religious kind of dictatorship. I pass that on. Well, there's somebody here, please.
I don't know if I can express this exactly right, but before the Abrahamic religions, there were goddesses.
Uh-huh.
And then we, humanity, saw the image of God as male.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there is a time coming again where we say, no, God is not male, it's also female. Can you comment on this violence and male and female images of God?
You know, I've a book I've always wanted to write. If you ever look at sect movements and whatever you want to call them, cult movements, fringe movements in Christian history. I'd love to write a history of the ones who prayed to our Father and Mother in heaven. And you'd actually be amazed how many of them did. Mary Baker Eddy in the 19th century. David Koresh in Waco prayed to our Father and Mother in heaven. Some of these folks were very admirable, some not. My only thought about that is that the religions which are growing most dramatically around the world and have grown most dramatically have tended to be very patriarchal. And above all, two religions especially have grown so much in the last 200 years, Christianity and Islam. And they have mopped up so many of the others. The story of Africa in the 20th century is that 50% of the population moved from pagan, primal religions with lots of goddesses to either Christianity or Islam. 50%, half. You did not ask this, but I will just mention this. Is there also a thought that a more goddess-oriented religion would be a less violent religion? We don't know. We don't have enough examples, but I would give you a major counterexample, which is Hinduism. Hinduism is a religion which is clearly has great many goddesses. It has no problem historically with war, with holy war, and has often created a pretty repressive and restricted setup for women in real life. So I'm not sure there's a correlation between whether or not a religion has goddesses and how, whatever you want to call it, peaceful, progressive, it is. It was the English worshippers of the Father God and Jesus Christ who stopped the goddess-worshipping Hindus burning widows. What could come again? Many things could come. But in terms of the trends over the last couple of hundred years, there are two great winners in the religious economy: Christianity in its various forms and Islam. And I honestly don't see any sign of that changing in the near future. And it's the primal religions with goddesses that have largely been mopped up, whether that's a good thing or a bad thing.
Thank you very much for your talk. You've made several references to the New Testament along the way, but the question I still have in my mind at this point is whether you can lift me out of my ignorance and make reference to specific statements attributed to Christ, which condoned violence, the use of violence in the way that you're describing it in your presentation.
I'm not aware of any. Never claimed there were. No, trust me. If there were any, they would have been front and center in the talk. Well, next time I talk, I'm going to wear a baseball cap.
Okay, I have a question. I'm currently in religion class. I'm not quite aware of everything that's going on with the holy wars, and I guess I understand a lot of your presentation. It's been really eye-opening. I am currently thinking about doing a project in Dr. Powell's class about liberation theology, and I guess I just want to kind of get your information and maybe see what you think about Pope Francis and his Jesuit background and whether or not this is going to bring liberation theology into the Catholic religion now, and maybe connect the government as well with it and cause some type of war.
Yeah. Not war, but... Francis has a very strong sense of social justice, economic justice. That comes from his Jesuit background, particularly his Latin American background. He comes from a country that's been marked by very intense economic crises over the last 40, 50 years, You've seen many people fall from being very solid middle-class folks to extreme poverty. Without the church, without that intervention, they would basically have been wiped out altogether. They wouldn't have survived. Can I see that being a big theme of church statements? Absolutely. What I would say, though, is always remember in Latin America, where he comes from, there's a big agenda item, which is the more the church has moved to liberation theology to help the poor, the more the poor have said, nah, no thanks. We're going off to the Pentecostal church over here. As the phrase goes, the church opted for the poor opted for the Pentecostals. And so the church has huge problems in poor parts of the world because so many of their natural constituencies have gone to other denominations, especially in countries like Brazil, Chile. Chile's like 30-35% Protestant these days, used to be 100% Catholic. But you can see Francis being making these kind of dramatic statements on poverty, labor issues, labor rights, environment, a lot of these issues that have been big in the forefront of Catholic thought for 70 or 80 years, really. But putting them more at the front of his ideas. Whether it's called liberation theology, not necessarily, but you're going to be hearing a lot more of that kind of social activism, so it's going to be a very good time to be studying it.
We have time for one more question. Okay.
What do you think, if you compare Bible with Quran, which book best describe about humanity without any contradiction?
Oh, a nice simple question to end with. No. I would not attempt to answer that as simply as that. I believe both books are very complex compositions. I would compare them in different ways, but I would end with one of my favorite verses from the Quran, which is one that many Christians would also like, which is if all the trees in all the forests were pens and all the seas were made of ink, we still wouldn't be able to write everything there is to be written about God. And I think I will end with that Quranic quote. Thank you very much.